Shalom, Rastafari. Okay, once again, I alone kone Tafari. It's still Shabbat time. Shabbat Shalom. We still got a few hours here in the West Coast. And I'm going to go to Exodus section, but I'm going to do a little something different. We're going to go to chapter 28. And we're going to start off with verse 34. A golden bell. Well, first, my bad. I wanted to. If it's possible, and you're able, take a look at the heavens. There's a lot of action. There was a meteor shower last week. If you live in the city and it's not possible, well, no big deal. It's a suggestion. There's constellation of Leo is very visible. It's been visible for the last few months, and it'll be visible up until August, June, July, August maybe. And also, there's going to be a lunar eclipse on the 20th of May. It's a Sunday. It's going to be visible. The best views are going to be in the U.S. and North America. So if you can check it out. There hasn't been a lunar eclipse like this one since 18 years, I believe. And watch, if you're going to look for a constellation of Leo, can you see it? Okay, you're going to be looking for this. It's really, really, it's really clear to see. This, I usually distinguish it by the tail. It's like a pyramid, like a triangle, whatever you call it. It's really, and then, well, basically this is what you're going to be looking for. Some say it's a backwards question mark. You see that? And Mars is right here. You're going to be able to see Mars right there. It looks red, actually. Venus is out there, too, and it looks really, really, really bright. Go ahead, if you're willing or even want to, just check it out. It's out there. Now, Exodus chapter 28, verse 34. A golden bell and a pomegranate. A golden bell and a pomegranate twice. It's very important, I guess, because they mention it twice. And it goes back to what I just read, Zechariah chapter 14. Now, which is why I'm including this. Upon the hem of the robe round about, and it shall be upon Aaron to minister, and his sound shall be heard when he goeth into the holy place before the Lord, and when he cometh up, that he die not. And thou shalt make a plate of pure gold, and grave upon it, like the engravings of a signet, holiness to the Lord. Thou shalt put it on a blue lace, that it may be upon the mitre, upon the forefront of the mitre it shall be. And it shall be upon Aaron's forehead, that Aaron may bear the iniquity of the holy things. I just wanted to include that because it has to do, obviously, with the kiddus, the holiness to the Lord, separate to the Lord. What it's describing here is basically, it's describing, it'll be something like this. So the mitre is pretty much like a, let's say some brethren has his, that looks horrible, has his dreads rolled up, and you know, okay, I guess that should be all right. And so let's see, this is I guess the turban around the head, and then it's a blue laced, meaning heavenly, and then it has a gold plaque up here, and it says holiness to the Lord. And this is also, like, if you can recall the crucifixion where they put the the sign up here, and this is for a token, for a sign, for a signet. And what was it that I wanted to mention? Oh, and Jah Willing, go into this because the sacrifices and the ram and all that has to do because of this this spiral. This it's the ram's horn in a sense. I guess a ram's horn would be kind of like. I can't remember. Well, let's say that that's a ram's horn. Let's just pretend, you know. I mean, we already live in a world of make-believe, so let's make believe that looks closer to a ram's horn than what it really is. So, and it's also the pillars, it's the pillars, I guess, of the temple. So everything, it's the snake wrapped around the pose, it's so many different, the abdominal region, which would be the six-pack, and then the strength, the might, the haile, the power. So much information behind that. The turban wrapped around the locks, the crown. And just wanted to, I guess, illuminate a little on the image. Okay, let us go to Exodus chapter. That's my dog. Pay no attention. He wants attention. Just really quick. Oh, it's not going to be quick. But, okay. Chapter 3. And verse 7. Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. Okay. Let I begin. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land to a good land and a large, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel, come to me. The cry of the children of Israel, come to me. And I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee to Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. The fulfillment of the Feast of Tabernacles. Jah came. He's saying right here, clearly, I have seen, like, I'm there. I've been not only spiritually, like I'm there, like I can tell. Moses, I'm gonna send you to the Pharaoh, to the big house, to the White House, or to the judge's house, the big judge institution, whatever, like the prison, they call it the big house, I believe, and in some cases. And so he's gonna take to the house. Jah is telling Moses that he's gonna. One second. And I will send thee. He will send it like Christ, like Jesus. Him who I am doing. Okay, I'm getting ahead of myself. I apologize. Now, give me a second to. I'm going to start again from verse 9. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel come to me. And I have also seen the oppression. I have seen, like, he's there. I have spoken to certain Rastafari, but, okay, that's beside the point. And I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore. He's calling them. Here's the call to Rastafari. And I will send thee the orders to the children of Israel out of Egypt. Oh, my bad. Send thee to Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Now, bring forth, like, he, up here, earlier it stated, to a good land, to good ground. And so now, to bring forth, the fourth seed was the one that landed on good ground, right? And so he's going to bring forth that good seed out of Egypt. Exodus, which is why this is up here, we're going to leave spiritual Egypt and we're getting out. We're moving out. Now, verse 11. And Moses said to Jah, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? Who am I? Remember earlier in Genesis, well, if you've been reading, how when God calls Abraham all the time, Abraham will answer, here am I. Because his name has not been established. His identity has not been established. And he has not yet been renamed to Abraham. And so this has to do with the law. This has to do with knowing thyself and the large amount of talk that has been regarding the judicial system and the problems I and I are confronted with today. Now, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? That I should go up to the judge, you know, the one that claims to be the intercessor, to be the big guy. Like, who am I? And here is the answer to our identity. And he says, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt. And he said, this is Jah speaking, certainly I will be with thee. Make thy wills obedient to good influences. In the line of Judah society, we've been going over this over and over. Let the will of I and I Father be done. Who sent Jesus Christos? Christos testified to him that sent him. Like in this case, there's the same is sending Moses. And so, who am I to go up against, you know, this system? I will be with thee. So, Jah will be with I and I, and the sign is that we keep the will and commandments of our God and Father, in and through Jesus Christos. And that itself will be a token, will be a sign. People will know who I and I is. For if we keep the will, Jah be with I and I, you know, always. Now, and he said, certainly I will be with thee, that his will be with I and I. And this shall be a token to thee, that I have sent thee. You see, who sent me? Like when Jesus is speaking to the disciples and he would always testify that who sent him. And then they ask, well, what is the way? I am Yahweh. Why is Jesus Christus the way? Why is he taking on the name I am? Because he fulfilled to the very smallest detail, he completely fulfilled, he was completely separated to Jah, and he fulfilled the will of the Father. That which sent Jesus. That is why Jesus is the way. Because Jah will be with him. And then they ask him, well, how are we going to know the Father? How long have you not been with I? Or something like that. How have you not been so long with I? And still you don't know the Father? Well, my will is, I mean, the Father be my will. You know, I be, he be. I'm sorry, let me get this right. I will be with thee. You know, like Jesus, the will of the Father was in Jesus. Therefore, if we know Jesus, we know the Father because the will is the same. And so, to continue. Verse 13, and Moses said to Jah, behold, when I come to the children of Israel and shall say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say then? So what is his name? And God said to Moses, I am that I am. So I am that. I am that. Exactly that. I am. I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say to the children of Israel, I am hath sent me. And so, continuing. And God said moreover to Moses, thus shalt thou say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, hath sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations. Back to Noah, and Jah remembered Noah. This is the token, this is the sign. I am Yahweh, the will of, this is holiness to the Lord. The will of Jah Rastafari is the way, is everything, is all ways. Not to say that there's many ways to get to the Father, except only through Geta Jesus Christos, for that's the only way. But once one seeks that way, Jesus is always, always with I and I, always to the Father. He is eternity, eternal, everlasting, the first and the last. And now, I lost my place. Good. And so this memorial is going to be that token in our foreheads forever, to all generations. So verse 16, go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac and of Jacob, appeared to me saying, I have surely visited you and seen that which is done to you in Egypt. The meeting place, it's nowadays. Like in the days of Noah, will be nowadays. And so it's been fulfilled that we've been called. We're trying to get to the meeting. But Jah has certainly visited us. You know, like Ras Adonis, him constantly be saying that the visit of his imperial majesty, Haile Selassie, I have surely visited thee. You know, I have seen the affliction, you know, and that's why I'm going to get you out of there. And so, tent of meetings. I don't even know why I said that. But, and now, and I have said, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, to a land flowing with milk and honey. And they shall hearken, and they shall hearken to thy voice, and thou shalt come, and all the elders of Israel, to the king of Egypt, and ye shall say to him, the Lord God of the Hebrews, of the Ebrawians, hath met with us. See, the Feast of Tabernacles, we've been partaking of trying to, we've been sharing the breaking of bread in this meeting of tabernacles, of tents, and of dwelling places. And now the kid. Give me just 1 second. My dog is going. Now hath met with us. And now let us go, we beseech thee, 3 days' journey into the wilderness, that we sacrifice to the Lord our God. Okay, to sum that all up, the king, who claims ownership of this world dominion? The Pope, the Holy See, the seat, the throne. He claims to be worthy of sitting upon the throne of this world, but it's rightfully Jah's, right? But I and I, as the inheritors, have not reclaimed. That's why this is the barely coming out, because we still haven't. This is like a court case. And so Moses is to go up to the stand and the judge, the one sitting on the seat, the king of Egypt, and in this case would the people of, I don't know, the republic, whatever they want to say, they're imagine, against, and they're going to ask you to state your name. I am. Because if you state the name that they have given you, you are accepting being the dominion, being an agent, a government agent, and therefore they're entitled to tax you and to do whatever they want because they're held liable for any of your actions. They can correct you. They can do whatever they want with you. But and not only that, if you go back to Genesis, the beginning, why was Adam allowed to name all the animals and beasts of the fields? Because he was given dominion over them, so he knew their nature. And Adam was given the right to name them. Now, if we claim a name that was given to us, then who do we belong to? To the dead body, to the dead birth, to the corporation. And so that's why, also in the Hebrew way of seeing things, it's circular, it's spiral, it's continual, it's everlasting, you know? If you don't describe someone by saying, oh yeah, he's short, skinny, long hair, and a certain color, certain features, that's nothing, that describes property. I am. Always, I am being. I am a living, breathing creature. I'm not this or I'm not that. I am what I want to be. And you know, like living. I am living. I am. I have breath. Now, if you say I am this, then you're that. But that's why. So Moses would go up to the judge and be like, "I am. Has sent me." You know. Oh, because once again, the birth, and the birth certificate. A life is manifested. A miraculous deed of Jah. And so the world don't know what to do with that. They're like, what? What is this? What do we do with this manifestation? And so quickly, parents are given, they take responsibility for that child, but then that manifestation comes with an inheritance, and the government, being what they are, they go ahead and take care of that inheritance until that manifestation comes to age and claims his trust fund, I guess his what's legally and rightfully his. And so parents are going to be held accountable for any actions up until he's a certain age, and then the government is going to hold the inheritance until the inheritor is of age to claim it. The thing is, I and I don't claim I and I inheritance. And so what's Moses is going to claim his people, Jah's people, and he's not gonna ask them. He's gonna beseech thee. We beseech thee. He's requesting. He's. I mean, in a kind way, but there's nothing they could be able to do in given case. I kind of forgot where I was going, so I'll just continue. And the Lord God of the Hebrews, of the overcomers. Those that have crossed, over, those that are from beyond your little fantasy world. Well, that reminds me that this world is Jah's, but Jah took, you know, Jah went to go. He's not that he's not dealing with Thy and I, but he's not here at the moment. So this Vatican little place, I guess they thought it'd be kind of them to take dominion and you know, make sure everything's okay, so when the earth rightful ruler come, everything be in place, you know. But I and I don't have to accept their services. I and I don't need them because we have Jesus Christos. Now, continuing. And the Abarawians, the Hebrews, all overcomers, so describing a variety of all those who overcome. And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go. No, not by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Now, okay, I'm going to skip over to... I know that's all random, right? But I'm going to skip over to chapter 4 because I just want to finish this quickly. So, chapter 4. And Moses answered and said, But behold, they will not believe me. It's not about believing. We've been make-believing in white light saviors for a while now. But, okay. Nor hearken to my voice, for they will say, the Lord hath not appeared to thee. And the Lord said to him, what is that in thine hand? And he said, a rod. And he said, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent, and Moses fled from before it. And the Lord said to Moses, put forth thine hand, and take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand, and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand, that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, hath appeared to thee. The Lord said furthermore to put his hand... Okay, I forgot to mention, and I forgot where exactly it is, but... It has to do with time. Let's see. Okay, it has to do with time. You see... how could I put this... Like, the first will be the last, and the last will be the first. Okay, let me continue with the other part until I remember what the time was. Okay, so he has a rod in his head. Moses says, they're not going to believe me. Josh says, what do you have in your hand? A rod. Cast it down. So he throws it down, right? Like I did this pencil. The pen is mightier than the sword, says Haile Selassie. Now, he cast it down, and it turned into a serpent. He fled from it, but then he went and grabbed it by the tail, by the back end, and it turned into a rod. Be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. This, we don't have to make them believe, we can prove it to them with this right here. Because the casting down, the casting is not only just throwing it, but throwing judgment, passing judgment is and we can judge upon that which has said to be, and we can prove it to be not. And now, this like, you know, coincidentally enough, Wendem Yaron. Yaron is he's a helper to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. Why? Because Yaron is representative of... it's that state of mind where one is able... To discern the thoughts, the inner thoughts of I and I, and to figure out and to know whether those thoughts are to be kept or to be cast out, to be judged as non-worthy to stay within I and I. You begin to break it down like, oh, this is good. I'll maintain this thought, and the nature of the thought. You know, you get to judge the nature of the thought, and if it's negative, then it's out. If it's positive, you keep it. And so it's kind of what's going on with the rod. We can cast down the serpent. We can judge and apply that which is. Good on good ground, you see. Plant the seed on good ground. We says here, and what is in thine hand? And he said, a rod. And he said, cast it on good ground. That's the key right there. I totally forgot. Cast it on good ground. Judge accordingly. Judge to Jah word. Judge. Make a good judgment. And he cast it on the ground. And he threw it on the good ground. Because, you know, Moses was already on holy ground. On good ground. On ground separated. Holy to Jah. So now, And then later on, it's going to explain how the whitewashing and put your hand into the bosom. But, you know, it just really briefly, some of the ideas and ways of interpretation and not just, you know, there's a lot of truth to what I and I speak. I'm sure I may have made some mistakes somewhere, but I hope whatever I said, any sister and her brethren can benefit from it. Oh, benefits. Well, let's not get into that. And let me just quickly see if there's anything. The time. I wanted to say it before, but I didn't. I don't know why. But you know when Jah says that you will not see my front side, you will only see my backside. Jah's going to be here first. You know, there's something about time, and I apologize because I can't remember. But I don't know how to explain it, but it's not with me right now. I wanted to say before that if we saw Haile Selassie face to face, we would have died and not been. You see, those that were actually with him, only few were faithful. But now that he's passed and we can only see the remnants of his accomplishments, gave us an opportunity to see the whole thing and to be able to read it in books and see videos and all of that. So that's also interesting to note that the first shall be the last and the last shall be the first, and we no longer be the tail but the head. So it's kind of a blessing that we weren't exactly there. Some or maybe some of us were too young or anything, but testimony to that is the prior generations. We are in a position where we can learn and follow the good will, the will of I and I, God and Father. And so I'll end with that until catch my breath, my spirit, I guess, and now grab something to eat. And I fully continue, and so thank you for just viewing. Shabbat Shalom. Rastafari.